Hi, it's Ted Patterson again from the Power BI CAT team. Good on you, you've made it to part three of the App Owns Data Starter Kit video series. So in this video, it's time to download the source code and open up the App Owns Data Starter Kit solution in Visual Studio. So in part one, we covered solution architecture. In part two, we basically set up our environment to make sure that Azure AD and Power BI are properly configured. And now we'll move on to getting started with testing the application. We're gonna start off by walking through how to install the required software. So we're gonna need .NET 5 SDK. We're gonna need Node.js. We use Node.js in the AppOwnsData client application to use the Webpack utility to compile TypeScript into JavaScript code. And then I'm gonna be using Visual Studio 2019. Now it is possible to basically load and test the application with Visual Studio code instead of Visual Studio 2019. So it's your choice. It's just as I go through the demonstration, I'll be using Visual Studio 2019. Let's start by going to the page where we download the .NET 5 SDK install. You can see that they have it for different operating systems. I'll choose the x64 version for Windows. We'll go ahead and download that. And now we'll go through the installation process to install the SDK. And we should smoothly go through and see that now we have the .NET SDK completely installed on our machine. Okay, let's keep going. Without further ado, let's go ahead and move over to Node.js. So on the Node.js, the main page, we'll download the 64-bit version for Windows with the MSI. And as we download that, now we'll start the installation. And this should install fairly quickly. Note that Node Package Manager gets installed along with that. It's a central part of Node.js. And once we start the installation, it should just take a couple seconds. And there you have it, all done. And once we've finally installed Node.js, okay, now we're gonna move to Visual Studio. This is the one that takes a while. Now you can use any version. I'm gonna install the community version, the one that's free and doesn't expire. But if you have the professional or one of the other editions, that's fine. And so at first, we're gonna install the Visual Studio installer. So it can ask me what parts of Visual Studio should we install? And I'm just gonna pick ASP.NET and web development. That's all I need. Now I've sped this up 50 times from what it would really take. Can you imagine how low I had to speak with my voice? So when it got sped up 50 times, my voice sounds normal as I'm talking to you here. Okay, and then finally, we should see that we're done installing Visual Studio. And we start up Visual Studio, and there is my version. I don't want to log in. I just want to get ahead and start up Visual Studio because that's what we're going to be opening our project in. Okay, now we got Visual Studio up and going. And now we're gonna take a victory lap and we're gonna install Visual Studio code. So once again, I'll install the Windows 64-bit version of Visual Studio code. Let's do it as fast as we can. We'll tell our processing chip, hurry, hurry, hurry. And also we'll say open with code as my Windows Explorer file context menu is always helpful. And now that we have installed Visual Studio code, let's go ahead and launch it. And now we've got all the developer software, installed on my machine and we're ready to go ahead and move ahead. Okay, well, let me catch my breath after installing all that software. Our next step is to download the source code, which we can go right to github.com/powerbi.devcamp and find the App Owns Data Starter Kit repository. Okay, so here we are at github.com/powerbidevcamp/appownsdatastarterkit. And what you can see here is that here's the top level folder. And the quick way to download the code is to drop down this code menu. Now, if you work with the Git utility, there's a quick way to call Git and then pass this URL. But if you don't work with Git, let's try the other way, which is just to download the source code as a zip archive. And once we download as a zip archive, I should be able to open the project. So let's go ahead and open this up. And inside of this zip archive, what we should see is that there is a main folder right here. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to right click. I'm going to choose copy. Now let's go over somewhere on my machine. So I have a folder where I put my projects called DevCamp. I'm just going to go ahead and paste that inside there. And so here comes all the source code for all the different projects. And so note that this is the main branch of this. And so that's why they've called this main, but maybe just to avoid some confusion, I'll go ahead and just rename my folder to just the App Owns Data Starter Kit. And inside, you know, what do we have? We have the SLN file. So let's go ahead and open this up in Visual Studio. I'll just double click on it. It should open Visual Studio. And then the solution, which includes those four projects, each in its own child folder, you know, should be inside there. Okay, a quick review of each of the four projects. App Owns Data Admin is an ASP.NET MVC web application built using .NET 5, and its goal is to help people who work for the hosting company who's doing the Power BI embedding to create tenants and to be able to assign user permissions. The App Owns Data Client is the SPA application that's built for our customers, and it needs to use the App Owns Data Web API, which is an ASP.NET Web API, which basically is going to be secured using Azure AD. And then finally, there's the App Owns Data Shared. That is a class library project, and it has entity framework code to create AppOwnsDataDB. And it also has C# code, kind of a wrapper class, so that when AppOwnsDataAdmin or AppOwnsData Web API code needs to access the database, you know, they go through code that is maintained in the AppOwnsData Shared project. Okay, so the next thing we need to do is we need to start with the AppOwnsDataAdmin application. And I'm going to start by opening the appsettings.json file and configuring the things in there that we need to configure. Let's begin by drilling into the AppOwnsDataAdmin project and finding the appsettings.json file. You know, as you open this up, you know, what you're going to see is that it has things for the tenant ID and the client ID that need to be filled in. So the first thing we're going to have you do is go back to that one file that you created where you have things like the tenant ID. You know, so let's take the tenant ID and now we'll basically copy that, you know, over into the tenant ID inside this configuration file. The next thing we want is the client ID. So let's go ahead and add that. And then finally, we need the client secret. You know, so basically this is going to act as the password when your application needs to authenticate as service principal. Now, the next section, Power BI service root URL. As long as you're using the standard Power BI public cloud, you don't have to change this. If you're using one of the sovereign clouds for Germany, for China, or for US government, you know, this URL would be different. The next thing we need is we need to have a connection string for the AppOwnsDataDB. Now, if you're using Visual Studio 2019, you know, this should work for you. I'm gonna leave this the way it is. Note that you could also change the server, you know, to point to either a local SQL server or an Azure SQL server, and you could actually create the database in an on-premise SQL database server or up in Azure SQL as well. Now, the last thing that we need is we're going to put in our account name. You know, so as I've been creating my environment, you know, I created an environment which is called dev env0504. And if I get this correct here, the main reason we need this is just kind of a demo setting. So the service principal for the AppOwnsData service app will actually be the one that creates the workspaces. It will automatically be an admin. But what we're going to do is we're going to add through configuration the name of an admin user. So when the provisioning logic creates the workspace, it will also add this user, the user account that you're demoing with, you know, such that you can get into the Power BI environment and see all the workspaces that were created. And at this point, you know, that's all we have to do in this file. So let's go ahead and save our changes and go ahead and close this out. Okay, now there's one more thing we have to do before we can test the AppOwnsDataAdmin app. And that is, we have to create the AppOwnsDataDB database. Now, the database is defined in the AppOwnsData Shared Class Library project. So it has entity framework code that we're going to use to create a new database. And this database is created using the code first approach, where you model your classes in C sharp and use those classes to create tables. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to look at the AppOwnsData shared project because it has classes named Power BI tenant, named user, and activity log entry. And what you're going to see is that there is another class, which is called AppOwnsDataDB. And if you've ever used the entity framework, when you create the top level database class, you derive from DB context. And then kind of the trick is that you then add these fields inside here, you know, based on your types, Power BI tenant, user, and activity log entry. And then you get to name what your tables are going to be. And we're going to use a set of PowerShell commands and we're going to run them. And it's going to basically take this C# code and build the logic to create the database. And then I'm going to run a second command that's going to create the database itself. Okay, now in order to do this, a couple things that we're going to have to do. First thing that we're going to have to do is we're going to have to open the NuGet Manager console. And we open the NuGet Package Manager console so we have a prompt that we can type and execute our PowerShell commands. Okay, and then another thing is that we've created the entity framework class, AppOwnsDataDB, in a class library project. And there's a rub there because the class library project cannot have its own configuration file. So we're gonna make the AppOwnsDataAdmin project, the startup project, and the idea is that the entity framework will use the configuration file and the connection string it finds inside there. But then before we run the commands, you know, we have to also, and this gets to be tricky, in the package manager console, look at the screenshot on the right, and there's a default project. You know, so we have to set that to AppOwnsDataShared because when we run these PowerShell commands from entity framework, we wanted to understand that that is the project, you know, that has all the code that we're going to use to generate the database. And then at the very end, once we get all this working properly, you know, what we're going to do is we're going to run two PowerShell commands. And this PowerShell code is defined by the entity framework. We're going to run the add migration and the update database commands. Okay, now before we build the database, let's one more time check the connection string. Now, another thing that you can do is if I go up into the Visual Studio View menu and let's go down to the SQL Server Object Explorer, you know, you can kind of see what are the kind of local servers that we have for Visual Studio. And I see that I have one local DB projects V13. Yeah, down here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of change that to the same thing I have, you know, which is projects, you know, V13. And the idea is that now that I've got the correct server, I can give the database, you know, any name that I want. And I'm just going to basically call it AppOwnsDataDB. And then I'll say integrated security equals true. You know, so once again, now the database connection string, you know, I know is correct. I'm going to come back up here into my project and I have the four different projects and I'm going to right click on the AppOwnsDataAdmin and I'm going to choose set as startup project. See how it becomes bold? That's how we know that when we go to the shared project and build the database that it will use the connection string from AppOwnsDataAdmin. Okay, now that we've got that, you know, let's go to the shared project. And in the shared project, I just kind of want to point out that there are package references to the entity framework and the extra library you need for SQL Server and for the tools to actually build things. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to bring up the package manager, the NuGet Package Manager console. So under Tools, NuGet Package Manager, and there is the Package Manager console. It's going to take a second to initialize. And then once it initializes, I'll just do a CLS to get rid of any text that's inside there. We're going to make sure that for the default project, we have AppOwnsDataShared. Okay, so now let's go ahead and run a couple commands. And so the first one is going to be add hyphen migration. And I'm going to go ahead and as I type this in, I'm going to hit the tab key just to make sure it recognizes things. Now, when you add a migration, you can name it anything that you want. And traditionally we call the first one the initial create. And let me go ahead and before I run this, let's kind of open up this project, which is the app owns data shared. Because, you know, as you run this command right here, you know, what we should see, you know, is that as it runs, it should then, you know, be able to create new code, you know, inside of this project. Okay, so the build succeeded. And one of the things that you'll see, you know, as part of the build process, it basically is able to create all this code. And you run the first command to kind of generate the code, which is why we ran add migration. And so now we'll do a second command, which is going to be the update database command. And this is the one that's going to use the code that just got created, you know, to actually create the database. And we'll go ahead and we'll run this. And now we see the build has been successful. And just to kind of verify that things really worked out the way I hope they did, you know, let's go back up here to the SQL Object Explorer. Let's go ahead and refresh. And there's the database that we just created. And if I drill down into the tables, you know, what we should be able to see is the three tables, users, tenants, and log activity. And if you're curious, and, you know, by gosh, you should be, you can go back, you know, into the AppOwns data shared. And if you open up models, you know, you can see here's the starting code where basically we have the Power BI tenant. We have the user class and we have the activity log entry class. And below that, you know, we have the app owns data DB with the DB context. One other little thing I wanted to point out is that down below, there's one more class, and this is the design time DB context factory. And the main reason this is here is so that we can basically put the connection string one time and have it used both to build the database, you know, and to resolve the database when the application starts up. You know, so once again, you know, here's a complete implementation, you know, of our entity framework model. And then one other thing I wanted to show is that this isn't necessarily entity framework code in the app owns data DB services. You know, this isn't code to create the database. This is code to consume, you know, basically to do read and write operations. And so once again, we wanted all the data access logic to be in app owns data shared. You know, so anytime there's a need for code in app owns data admin or app owns data web API to access the database, you know, it goes through this app owns data DB service class, you know, which is in the shared project. Okay, so at this point, now we have everything set, and I think we're all ready to test out the admin application. So at this point, you've seen how we create the app owns data DB database with those PowerShell commands, add migration and update database. Okay, well, now you've made it through part three. And so now things are getting exciting because we're going to move on to part four. We're actually going to hit the F5 key and start running the AppOwnsData admin application in the Visual Studio Debugger and start bringing the application to life.